It's fine. But let's start. So how many of you are game designers or want to become one? And how many of you really would never make a game in your life, like not interested in making games? Yeah, wow. All right, fine. So it's cool that I'm like going in more like detail on the perspective of like how to make games. Not like teaching you how to make games, but like what if we made games this way? And we can do next. Oh, okay. No, there's the Bluetooth mouse coming.
I hope this thing still works from here.
Splay, right? Play. Yay.
It might not click every time you click, but it
will. I'll keep an eye on it.
Oh, round of applause for Pietro, everyone.
Yay! So in 2010, I started an indie game studio with my friend and colleague Nicola Tedeschi that's called Santa Ragione, and we make sort of a, like alternative games, but also commercial outclick. Commercial games like our board game, Escape from the Aliens in Outer Space. It's about escaping from the aliens in outer space. Wheels of Aurelia is a narrative driving game set in Italy in the late 70s. Mirror Moon EP is a space exploration game about being really alone. And Photonica is a game about running and jumping. So not that experimental, but... Aside from Santa Ragione, I worked on a number of smaller things, like a video cassette rental simulator called Video Heroes, a simulation of the 2013 Italian elections called Final Candidation, an awkward sex game that you see in the middle, writing poetry in Italy, books, messages from space, and, you know, sort of like different things. This is an adaptation of 100 Years of Solitude that lasts half a second. Gameplay, I would recommend it. Check it out. It's called Mariposas Amarillas, Yellow Butterflies. And click. Oh man, next would have worked so much better. Aside from games, I also organize a number of events. We used to do Lunar Arcade back like from 2011 to 2013. We did it in Sydney, we did it in Shanghai, in Milan. And now I'm organizing a game festival. It's called the Milano Game Festival. It takes place in Milan in autumn, that is shaped as a film festival, meaning that you have a room with 30 computers, 60 people at a time can come every night. Every night we play a different game, and everybody sits down and plays the same game for 2 hours. And then they get to meet the authors and discuss the game with the players. So they play it through like a full game, as if you were in a film festival. Which is that thing on the right. And the thing on the left inside is just a collection I created for the Triennale Museum in Milan, and is indie games, very short indie games, made especially for the Triennale. So this is a virtual exhibition you can download on your phone or on your iPad and play through it. And so you could say that the main thing that we're worried about is something that I'm worried about is this idea of finding a new audience. Like, we, both for a very practical commercial reason, as in we need to find someone to sell our games to, and also because we really think that we need to advance the medium in a certain direction that makes it interesting to people that are not normally interested in video games, but that have other interests that are, you know, really sort of like, you know, culture in general, art, literature, humanities, if you will, and that we have to cater to these people and learn how to make games for these people, so that you know, we create a body of work that is big enough to attract these people to our medium, and then this, like, it's like a positive loop that starts happening, it keeps on happening, and games become this fantastic new art form that we all wish to be. Unless you think it is ready, in that case, I don't care. But sure. So how do we do that? Like, how do we make this evolution happen? The thing is that I believe we do not have a clear design perspective, as in like where to start, like what are the next steps into going towards this direction, aside from like all these tiny experiments that I've made. But this process that I've made, that you've made, that everyone is making, that shares this particular viewpoint. So in the last 3-4 years, I've been thinking about what are the ingredients that when applying to game design would like very likely force us towards that direction. Let's say like a set of tools that you apply to your game design, and then you end up with something that can be sold and it can be attractive to these particular people. And like because all these ideas are like very aspirational, they haven't been really tested, and also they're slightly controversial, as you'll see, they take the form of... Well, it doesn't really work with setting up expectation to the next slide and then switch it to it at the right time. A manifesto that I called Rejecta, a non-traditional playable media manifesto that kind of like wants to give everybody an inspiration to start making games that go towards that direction that we've just discussed. And you can, so I presented this originally at Indiecade in Paris a few months ago. And you can see the full manifesto at activeplay.com/rejecta. And I'm not going to go through every single point and subpoint today, but I just give you an overview of everything that's covered in the manifesto, and then tell you what happened when we tried to apply it for the first time a month ago. So point one, click. It's 2 clicks. She said she had accepted it's double click. Point one is the game is flow like a river. Time must exist beyond the player's action. This means that so traditional games are this sequence of eternal moments that players move through. Like you are used to have games wait for you, and just the story doesn't progress unless you make it progress. And it doesn't flow like a river at all. It's just this step after step of scripted sequences. And instead, I argue that we need to design games a little bit more like movies, which is, you know, an idea that was gonna come back in the manifesto quite a lot. That like no matter what happens, no matter what the player does, then the game progresses by itself. No! Haha! So, previous slide that I cannot go back to.
Previous slide.
Thank you. So it's self-explanatory. The setting must be strictly instrumental to content and meaning. Just means not designing games, starting from the gameplay and then adding the context to it, the story to maybe to explain the gameplay, to justify the gameplay, whatever. It should always be the opposite direction of like finding a topic, like something to talk about, a story setting, and then finding how that can be expressed through gameplay rather than vice versa. Source material and collaborations must be found outside of games and related subcultures, and we know what this refers to, the culture of nerd cultures of technology, be it like superhero comics or fandom or sports, even just this whatever is usually the topics that games cover. Let's not do that. Let's try to do something else voluntarily. No games should last more than 2 hours. It's very crucial because the kind of people that I was telling you about in the beginning, and I'm sure many of you as well, we don't have that much time to spend in games. And we also, I'm sure some of you would agree that we've had played games where after 2 hours we would really understand what this game had to offer. Or that interesting content was added. It was just separated by not uninteresting content all the way through the game. You'd feel like, oh man, if this were lasted 2 hours, it would have been so intense and so meaningful, and instead of just like spending time grinding to see the next like interesting set piece that the game is proposing. So if we aimed at this amount of time that everybody has, but everybody is willing to commit to a certain kind of like cultural consumption, then we could attract again those kind of people that we're aiming for. This is beautiful. It's very important. I highly recommend And to apply this, this means just full production. You can start pre-production before and then market. Like, can take a whole year to publish a game, but do not work on your game more than 6 months. There is a reason to do so, which is to keep budget small and also to keep your game relevant. Because in a hypothetical scenario where we are advancing the medium at light speed, you don't want to end up in 6 months with a game that is obsolete in terms of like the advancements in interaction that it has done. So I recommend we try and not crunch, but work in 6 months and try to make a small game the last 2 hours, maximum. Human condition must be the topic, genre games are not acceptable. It's kind of like evolution to the previous point as to what games should really be about, and make them be about, you know, birth, growth, aspirations, conflict, mortality, and not about just like the strict meaning of conflict and resolution that we're used to when we think about what games are about in terms of challenges, but really just focus on the human aspects and realistic characters, which I think is what representing human condition really means, is to have realistic characters that we can relate to on certain degrees or not, but you can still find them grounded in reality in some point or way. To do that, all video game tradition and form style and content must be rejected. That means basically to question every single step that we've taken so far into making game design what it is today. So whenever you apply something that is traditional of game structure, you look at it and you're like, "What is this really necessary? Is this something that I'm putting in the game because I want it to be, to feel easy to play for people that have already played these games and try to appeal to specific audiences that play these other games? So I'm putting this thing in, and is this particular thing something that people that are not interested in games are going to be turned off by?" So this is a really critical point of the manifesto that I think we should really think about, is like how many things that we put in our games end up being unappealing to a wider audience. It can even just be like, you know, pixel art. It just says the perception of gaming that is from the kind of people that we're aiming for is inevitably tied with a certain kind of content. So even if you make like a very serious, very mature game about human condition, but then you make it in pixel art, the people that you're trying to reach to are probably going to see it and think it cannot be about important topic because it reminds them of those. So keep in mind that these are not like an ideological point of view, but like ideas to try and solve a particular problem, a particular perception problem. They're also ideological, but it shouldn't focus on that. Acting and performance must be central assets and affecting gameplay. It means that you have actors, you need to have a human component that is present in the game that grounds you in reality, in achieving an aesthetic and an experience that feels familiar to people that are used to theater and cinema, and they're not like willing to go through abstract planes of representation to understand whatever you mean through your gameplay. And I think just getting this focus on like making humanity, and you know, I mean, with performance, I mean all performance arts, just means dancing, for example, or just even voice acting, and just remind your audience that there are humans inside this game world that you're representing. And that ends up covering, for example, all the environmental storytelling games that can feel very empty and very unhuman to people that are expected, they're expecting to see stories about characters. And so this is something that we should think about. So this is kind of the trickiest one. The results of the game's design must be uncertain, and then only unanswered questions must be asked. It's kind of like having this perspective as designers going through this innovation phase that we very, very heavily we cannot, you know, do a traditional game design production cycle where you have a vision for the game and then that is based on mechanics and dynamics. and then you try to realize it, and then through iteration, you eventually define whatever you plan, then you just go in with this idea of realizing the design, but instead doing like an anti-design perspective that is more based on improvisation, where you set up the possibility of emergent situation that you do not have full control of, and just let the game speak to you. But this is kind of, this is very hard to just go from this thought to actual design practices to make this happen. So maybe this is a topic for another talk. We'll see. Final point, very, very self-explanatory again. This is ideological, but it also fits into the just making this widespread and making this into a movement and make this into something that can change things more as a whole rather than just it being a subgenre or whatever, is to make it socially accessible, and that means like not charge for your game more than whatever the price of a cheap meal is anywhere in the world that you're selling your game in. And balance it with your life so that you're all also alive in the process. So at the Global Game Jam 2017, we tried, me and longtime collaborators of Santa Ragione, Paolo Taillet, and Niccolo Sala, together with 3D artist Elena Montuschi and writer Luca Esposito, we tried to apply all these ideas for the first time into a brief game. I'm showing you a big trailer for it. Works. It doesn't work. That's all my mouse. No? Yes? Just quick. It's fine. Yeah? No? Looks good. Just 48 hours, and we've never tried to like understand the design repercussions of whatever is in this manifesto. So we had these 48 hours to try and see, so how does this translate into practice? How does this change the way that we actually make the game? So we tried to put everything in and see where it took us. No. Can we go one back? No? Up. Yeah, oh, yes, it's this one, sorry. So some stuff was easier, like designing an accessible interface that didn't feel very gamey, although you can say that it's a variation of what you expect from a money click game. So we had these three cursors where it would like imply interactivity, exploration, and this was for transitions between scenes. And the way we made it accessible in the game is that like every item in the game is a very sparse scenography, and every item in the game leads to an interaction, and this interaction is not easily predictable. And that means we never set an expectation as to what that's what in the game. It's like, well, what happens if I click the pack of cigarettes? Like, I expect them to expect the character to smoke them, but what does that mean in the context of the game? So we never had the problem of like players trying to achieve something that they wouldn't be able to, but rather just exploring what was interactive in the world and then going with it. No. Yes, thank you. And like we took very clear shortcut to achieve the sense of realism that I was telling you about before. We have like this typical indie post-processing effect, covering the fact that all assets come from different parts and they're reused assets and they are all made by different artists very quickly in just 48 hours. And we work with this color code to make, you know, characters understandable from the scenery. But this just, again, this was like the easy part of making the game, as again, they're grounded in reality, accessible, and respecting the easiest points of the manifesto. But by far, the hardest part of applying Rejecta was to work with this first point, that the game must flow like a river. And if you think about it, a lot of the rejection that the manifesto talks about can be condensed, can be understood through the lenses of this expression. Because just try and apply this idea to the last game you've made, or to the last game you've played, and or your favorite game, and you would see how deeply it transforms the way it happens, the way that the game is played. So, and very few games attempt to do that, and I'll go into that in a second. So, the corollaries to that point is that the actions always happen in real time, the world must never be frozen, that events must exist independently from player's action, and then all fail states are rejected, and we never wait for player's input to advance the story. And you can easily see how this affects accessibility, because you remove completely the pressure and responsibility from the player to advance the game, to succeed at the game, because they know that there is this world that is happening no matter what. And of course, there's massive implications in how the interaction with the story happens, because you have to real-time adapt to players' action that could happen at any time and make them feel that they are part of this self-evolving plot that is happening in the game. And of course, it affects the duration of the game. It's very easy to make a game that lasts 2 hours if you just stick to this principle. So you just make a narration that lasts for 2 hours and it just ends, and then your game lasts 2 hours, and whatever the players experience, it works. And of course, it changes the kind of collaborations you have to do, because this works way more like dramaturgy in theater. So it would, like, if you were planning for a game to work like this, I will, and you should talk with someone who works in theater and understand what goes on in directing this. This means that you would never have characters waiting for you to speak to them, like you've seen in the majority of like JRPGs or like those kind of role-playing games. And this all contributes to making a player feel like they're participating to an event, to something, and not just directing themselves. The repercussions of these points are become really evident the moment you try to implement them in your game design. For example, there's this scene that you might have seen in the trailer as a tribunal, and it's, I don't know how familiar you are, I'm sure you are pretty much a little bit familiar with the story of the stranger, but basically, 10 minutes? I have like 100 more slides. Jesus. All right, very quickly. So the character in the novel is going through a trial where he's accused of basically killing someone without a reason, and he's like basically explaining this to the reader and going through whatever happened, and he has this massive sense of like inability to interact, to change what happened and change the future. And this fits very well with the idea that players are not the central protagonist of the game in this particular case, but also poses an important question as to who the player is inside these kinds of games. Is this more like a witness rather than a protagonist? And does it mean that whenever we have first-person narration, we have to design real third-person games, meaning not just the third-person camera point of view, but actually games that are about people that are not the player, and that the player is just a witness to whatever is happening in the game. So we work with this, and so the first step, this is like a cheat sheet to stranger in high school. But what we did was kind of like deconstruct the novel and see whatever could be made into something that happens by itself and something that is interactive. And what we ended up with was breaking it down into scenes that are all happening at the same time in the character's mind. And so the main character is in jail already after committing the crime, and they're thinking about what happened. And so the player, for example, clicks on the pack of cigarette, the character starts smoking a cigarette, and suddenly he is on the beach when he was smoking. So the player plays the role of the kind of like stream of consciousness of the main character. So it's not the main character. And this is changing this point of view, I think, is going to be crucial whenever we make game worlds that happen by themselves. And another problem that I didn't expect to have was the perception of frozen time. Like, we were so used to games that wait for us that even if we see worlds that feel alive in some respect, we still expect all the events of the game to be waiting for our contribution. Like, you're on the beach and you see that you know, the seagulls are flying and the waves are breaking on the shore, and you have no idea that stuff is happening at the time. You're just like, okay, I can sit here until I want, and then I'll progress in the game. But actually, so the problem is, how do you make player know that this is happening while they are doing this? They're just relaxing on the beach, and there's like a crime happening 100 meters from them, and then, you know, they hear a gunshot, but they do not witness it. And how do we work with like attracting player attention as to what is happening in the game? And to speak about this, yeah, good. That was good. I want to show you some games that try to tackle this problem in the past. And one of them is The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask 2000 on Nintendo 64, and is a game about, you know, adventuring as Link as per usual. But the difference is that the game takes place over the course of 3 days, during which there's this massive moon that is crashing on the planet, and you have only 3 days to save the world. And there is a clock here, yeah, this one, that shows you in real time. I don't know if this is just in the beta, it's in the real game, but there's another representation if it's not this one. But it shows you like how close the moon is to the surface of the planet, so you can plan accordingly. But more interesting than that is that over the course of these 3 days, events happen and characters have schedules that you have to adapt to if you want to interact with them and like have meaningful progress in the game. And this is, wait, can we go one back? This is managing the game through this interface called the Bomber's Notebook, and it's basically like a calendar app that shows like what every character that you've encountered is doing during these 3 days, so you can plan, on the second day I'm going to be at the market because there is a sale, for example, and then I'm paying for the items less than I would be. And then and others are more like story-related events. So it has this very, very in-your-face interface about this, and it handles the problem of like, how do I let players know about events they're not witnessing directly by having like a network of information where you hear rumors that something is happening at a certain spot at a certain time, and this get logged. This is the 3DS version in your notebook, again, your bumper book, and then you can, you know, react to that. These always only work if you are making a game that is loopable, that it works as a loop. This is a trailer as well. Yeah, cool. This is another example of a time-based game. It's called The Last Express in 1997. And it's a first-person point-and-click adventure game that takes place on the Orient Express during, again, the 3 days before World War I, and is a murder mystery, and is also a political thriller where you explore this train and the people that are in it and try to understand what happened to the person that you were supposed to meet on the train when you boarded. And it's very unique in the sense that it has this, all this narrative that is happening no matter what the player does. So typically your experience would be that you would be walking past a compartment and overhear, it's not gonna happen.
and over here, a conversation that is only happening at that specific time. And that conversation is like crucial to your understanding of the plot. And you're like, wow, if I hadn't been here at this very particular moment, I would never understood what was going to happen later on. And then you have instances of like deciding what to do at specific. Am I going to the restaurant cart, or am I staying here talking to this person? And what, based on what you do, just the story changes in real time. And this game solves some of the accessibility problems of this scenario by having this clock interface that lets you rewind time. So where Majora's Mask has this looping mechanic, there's these 3 days playing over and over and over, this basically do the same thing with the clock, where you should rewind to change the outcome of the story. Because it has this, so the story can go bad, like you can get killed, or you can just like onboard the train, and then the story ends, but it's clearly not like a real ending. It's just like a hidden game over screen. And then what you have to do is go back to this interface, rewind time, and start back from a city or like a particular point that you remember that was crucial in the game. Like, for example, yeah, there's this violin concert that you can attend to and just listen to someone play a violin for like 20 minutes in-game real time, which means like hours in the train ride. And if you do that, you miss out on important things. So you'd be like, oh, so what happened if I go back to that particular concert and then change what I'm going to do? What's going to happen then? You try that through this interface, and you see that there is different outcomes. So yeah, that was true. Yeah. This is an indie game, upcoming indie game, releasing this year. It's called Elsinore. It's made by Golden Glitch Studio, I'm pretty sure. Yeah. And it's about Shakespeare's Hamlet, and you play as Ophelia trying to change the outcome of the tragedy, and of course, particularly what happens to her. And the structure of the game, you know, it's in real time, everything's happening based on the script, but based on what you do, the story changes, and what you do is basically spread information. So it's the main gameplay item is being somewhere and witnessing something gives you pieces of information that then you can share with other characters, and these characters in turn will rely the same information to other characters, and this spread of information will just change how the plot happens. I think it's very interesting. It's coming out next year, so okay, good. But it's similar to this other crazy game. Sentient by Psygnosis. I think this is also 1997. ISA trailer. Yay. I recommend playing this. This insanity of a game is like a text adventure mixed with like a schedule-based RPG that is also a simulation of a spaceship that is going towards the sun. And then and you play by interacting with the characters and, again, spreading information. Like, you can tell, this is 1997, and you can tell characters to tell things to other characters that then will act upon that information. And every character in this world has a schedule. They will just act their things. And this whole spaceship is simulated. Every room has, like, an interface that you can interact with to change, you know, the oxygen levels. And that will change the spread of this radiation sickness that is affecting the space station that you're supposed to cure. It's really cool and really weird and really unsuccessful because it wasn't very, very accessible. But I think it's very interesting for us to see how they tackle these problems that basically have been tackled between 1997 and the year 2000 and then are only now becoming, again, like a central problem of game design. For example, two other indie games that are coming out next year. On your left is The Sex Brutal, and on your right is 12 Minutes. And they're both murder mysteries stuck in a loop. So you play over and over the events of what happened. One is very like funny and cheerful, and the other one is like super grim and realistic about a home invasion. But basically the interaction is the same as you'd see what would happen at that particular time if I do this, and then change whatever you've done in the next loop. And as you can see, all these games have a common interface of like showing a clock to let you like understand the relationship between the schedules and the time that is passing. Another indie game that is trying this is 2015 Seamus McNally winner Outer Wilds that is also coming out this year probably. And it's, again, it's like a loop of 20 minutes. This is the last 20 minutes of this solar system before the sun explodes. And you have 20 minutes to explore the surrounding planets of the system. And whatever happens on each planet is dependent on the schedule and the time that is passing in these 20 minutes. So something that is accessible at minute 5 could not be accessible at minute 15. So you, each loop, again, you have to decide what to see, what to interact with, and based on the experience that you make on these schedules that are happening, you change your actions. So in the next thing, I feel like I'm almost done. Shenmue. I'm sure everybody knows about this game. Doesn't have audio, doesn't matter. This is 1999, and the crazy people made a game where every single character in a pretty large neighborhood in Japan have their own schedule and lifestyles. And the crazy thing is that you can interact with each one of them, and they all have dubbed lines that are based on whatever you are researching at that particular time. So let's say at the beginning of the game, you were investigating if anyone had seen a black car, and you go to every single character in the game, and you tell them, have you seen a black car on that day? And they have a reply for that question. And that changes every 5 minutes of the game, and you can see that all these characters in this neighborhood have their personality, they have their life, they have their schedule, they have their relationship to their protagonist because it's a very small village. And so, yeah, you have this schedule-based gameplay that is although a little different to what I am advocating now. So these are two elements of the game you will see very often. One is the loading screen that'll tell you what time it is, where you are, and the other one is the diary in which the protagonist writes down everything they're supposed to do and whatever happened in the game because it's really hard to keep track of everything that is happening in the game. And but this is a little different than having like your game be one single schedule. It's more like whatever games like Skyrim and such are doing, where they have this day-night cycle where there are scheduled events that you can interact with, but you can interact with these events every day. So they're always there at a specific time, but they're not participating in an overarching storyline that happens no matter what. So this is, a different approach. And, I think Ultima 7 was the first game to do this. But there were games to try and do what we are trying to do before that. And this is like same year as Shenmue came out. It's called Mizurna Falls. It's by the makers of Clock Tower, the horror game. And is again, this is an adventure exploration game that it happens in real time. As you can see, there are clocks everywhere in this game. There's a watch on the screen all the time. And it's basically like a spiritual predecessor to Deadly Premonition. And it's also very Twin Peaks inspired. And I recommend you check it out because it has very interesting schedule-based mechanics. Finally, last thing. This is Pathologic. It's a Russian 2005 first-person adventure game in which you live through 12 days, and basically every day one of the main characters is going to die, and you can save them, and based on whether you save them or not, you have a limited amount of time, the story changes. And it's a really weird game that's currently being remade after a successful Kickstarter, and I also recommend you check this one out. It's really hard to show you the gameplay of all these games just because the thing that I should show you is how they change through time, but there's this clock interface here, again, that show you what day it is, what time it is. And just to draw some conclusions before I let you go, we have, I think, five main problems that we need to tackle next to solve this massive design problem and to achieve worlds that flow like a river. It is the inaccessibility of this clock scheduling interface. I'm sure this is not the best way to do this. It's very in your face. It's not very accessible. It's not very attractive to people that are not gamers. The problem of unawareness and of unwitnessed events is unsolved by all these games. They all have this idea of looping to make it meaningful, that you will learn about something you have not witnessed so you can witness it the next time you play. But we need to find ways so that this can be contained within one single playthrough and not just make all our games about time loops. How do we make people understand that the time is flowing? Because gamers are not used to that idea. But this could be like a fake problem, because if people are not gamers, maybe they just expect the time to flow. So this, I suspect that we need to do further testing of whether this is a real problem or not. And then this problem of unpredictability of player engagement, like in Elsinore, if you, as Ophelia, you stay still, just the tragedy ends and nothing happens. And you know, that's a problem. I mean, it since it's a gamer game, I think in some ways, it's fine because you're like, you're just playing against the game. But I think some of the people that we're trying to reach to would not understand that they have to make concessions to the game that they're playing and that they have to play along. But we need to find ways to get them used to the idea that they need to play along. And I don't know how to do that yet. And finally, what we said before, like what is the role of the player in these worlds? Maybe they're witnesses, maybe they're entities, maybe they're like directors, I don't know. And this is also like a whole new language of player impersonation in game design that we need to work towards. So what now? Please let me know, get in touch, let me know what you think about the Rejecta Manifesto, and let me know if you're making games about it. And participate just from a theoretical standpoint, from a practical standpoint. Let me know if you try find solutions to these design problems. And this is like, I don't know if I can do this, but maybe Amaze 17, we're trying to do a workshop that is on the production of this kind of game. So what do you need to do at pre-production? Like what planning for these specific design problems? And yeah, that's it. Thank you. These are the games that you should check out. Take a picture.
Thank you very much. So it's now the lunch break, so we're not encroaching on anyone else's time. You should definitely go for lunch if you want to, but if you're able to do a Q&A,
yeah, I am.
Then I'm happy to like be here for 5 minutes. So if you want to stick around for a Q&A, you're very welcome. If you're leaving, then I encourage you to come back after the lunch for what I'm dubbing the barely controlled chaos 90 minutes, which is like a four-way conversation with two head mics and one hand mic. Between Sock Pop. Pat, are you curating that now? Is that decided when we were drunk last night?
Yeah, I might be.
Okay. Possibly curated by the Pat Ash. and then followed by William Pugh and Ed Key having an argument on stage for 45 minutes. So I do encourage you to come back for that session. It's going to be great. So I'm going to kick us off with a question, and then we'll obviously accept questions from the audience if you have any. So I guess I wanted to start with, I know that the talk was in and of itself an exploration of one of the difficulties that you discovered through trying to implement a manifesto, but I sort of wanted to ask a question about manifestos so we don't get hung up on the manifesto.
Okay.
And the question that I wanted to ask was, like, obviously the value of manifesto in art, from Marionetti to the Gorilla Girls, is really obvious. It's like a statement of intent. But I think that possibly in games, manifesto, the act of making manifestos in lots of arts is just the same as, oh, we got drunk and we decided these things and now we're going to try and make some things on that. Or sometimes it's an academic exercise, but perhaps not so well known in games. So I wondered if you wanted to talk really quickly about why you decided to make a manifesto and how the practice of that has helped shape what you're now making.
Yeah, so good question. So I did a PhD in interaction design that I finished in 2014, and that was about designing playable experiences that are not objective-based or challenge-based. And like doing that, I developed this interest, if you will, in creating knowledge that was possible to be applied as, you know, and reproduced, which is the very idea of doing research in academia. And so when I was thinking about it, so the main thing comes from the kind of games that I want to play. Mm-hmm. Like every year there is like two games that I really like, and it's like, you know, Her Story or Divine Six. And I'm like, I wish there were more games that I would really get excited about. So what are the ingredients that make these games be so exciting for me? And as I was trying to understand that, it's something that it's still happening. It took me years of thinking about this thing. And I'm like, is it possible as a designer for me to try and make this into repeatable guidelines that can be used? So as I was writing this, like, what do I need? What do games need to do for me to like them? I discovered that a lot of these ideas were very aspirational and possibly very wrong. So that cannot take the form of a manual, but rather it works better as a manifesto because it's kind of understood that, you know, it can be kind of crazy, can be completely wrong. It can be, you know, it's fine. Mm-hmm. It's not scientific research. It is an aspiration as an artist to try and make these things.
Awesome, thank you. Questions from the audience? Straight up at the back there. I have to repeat. Yeah. Can you repeat the question because I didn't catch that?
So the question, if I understand correctly, is can you give an example of a game that fits within the manifesto, right? And the answer is no. There is currently no game that does all of these things. Certainly not one that's been developed in 6 months. but I would say that the Last Express that I've shown you gets really close because it's all rotoscoped, so performance is very central. It has this very unusual setting and topic for a video game that is, you know, pre-World War I, mm-hmm. and has this, you know, the game world happening independently from players' action. So there is a lot going on there that I think we should look at.
What led you to identify time as such a central aspect of the manifesto?
Right.
Repeating the question, what led you to, for the benefit of the recording, consider time as being such a central concept as part of the manifesto?
Yeah, well, that's very, very good observation. The main thing, so everything starts from the idea that people do not have infinite amount of times. And as you grow up, and as you have more interests and are interested in, you know, you want to have an exciting life, you want to travel, but you also want to learn more about the world and just entertain yourself. And while you're trying to do these things, the amount of time every day that you have for each of these activities in the first world, where you are like lucky enough to have like a life that is, you know, relaxed enough so you can entertain yourself, and it also leaves you enough time from work that you can enjoy life, then you would want something that fits within this lifestyle. And I don't think that games currently do that. And so I think we need to provide experiences that are very meaningful in a very short amount of time. And from that idea, kind of like everything cascades from that, that you would need those to happen no matter what, because you can't get stuck. Because you get stuck, then the game can take forever, etc.
Any other questions at the front here?
My question is about your desire to bring your audiences to games. Mm-hmm. So from what I understood, the motivation behind creating content is twofold. So on one hand, to challenge our practice as designers, but also to bring in new audiences. And I think you really demonstrated through your talk how you managed to sort of freshen things up and produce new design paradigms and new ways of thinking about games. But what I'm not seeing, but I'm also wondering whether it's necessary at all, is whether the kinds of games that this manifesto produces are really more accessible to new audiences, apart from having a shorter time. Let's say it's only 2 hours, but are they really more accessible? That's what I'm wondering.
Yeah, I'm going to repeat the question for the benefit of the recording. I'm sorry.
Just here.
Identifying two really useful things there. So that the manifesto does two primary things. Number one, it challenges our practice as game designers and artists. But secondarily, it is particularly aimed at bringing new audiences in. And do you have, a proof or a plan or an idea for how we might discover whether or not that's being effective?
That's a terrifying question, and I have no idea. As a matter of fact, The Last Express was critically acclaimed, but it's a major disaster from a marketing standpoint. And I don't know. It could be that we try and do all these things and learn that they don't change anything about the perspective, the perception of games that we're having right now, and that do not attract a new audience. This is just, it's a feeling for me that maybe this is the direction. And what I know for sure is that if we try to design things based on the principle, we will end up with something that is radically different, and maybe there's no audience for it. But I don't think that there is any way to find out unless we actually like try to make it. And that is also why it's so important that we have like short development cycles and smaller games, is because we can't risk millions of dollars trying to make this. We need to find like an affordable space for experimenting, and we need to do it all at the same time to see quickly if really the problem is that there is not a body of work that is large enough to attract these audiences.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a really strong response. And I think that also there's that difference between like manifesto and methodology, in that you have a manifesto to test some ideas and just like actually get there and start making things. And methodologies give you are a more scientific approach by which you would test your theories again and again and again, but they would allow you to be less agile. So if the problem is a body of work, it feels like obviously the solution is to build a body of work. I'm sure that there are loads of other factors like platforms and hearing about the thing and your ideas about yourself, like could like most of the people who know who don't play games, like do they think it's not a thing they would do because of their gender, their age, their like ability with computers, all these kinds of things, the controls. There are so many factors involved in this, but to me personally, as a maker and an enjoyer of manifestos, I like the provocation to start building that body of work and asking those questions quickly and now. My opinion wasn't what was being asked for then, but yeah, I stated it. Sorry. This is what you get if you ask me to present things.
I couldn't have said it better myself.
So one point of the manifesto is the accessibility in terms of price. And, right. Don't you think that like part of that specific point should also be tied together with distribution systems?
Repeat the question for the benefit of the recording.
So the question was about price and whether or not and price accessibility and if that should be tied to distribution system thinking.
Yeah. Strongly affects how you reach your
yeah. Audience. Okay.
So my answer to that is that in the full manifesto, for which every of these points has 4 or 5 corollaries, this is covered, and what I say there is that. You should work with established platforms that are large enough that this can get traction and that they reach out to people that are not gamers. Unfortunately, today, that's basically the App Store, which conversely does not allow for certain kind of political and more engaged content. So, massive problem there. And I would also argue that this doesn't work very well in spaces of experimental technology, like, say, VR, because this is not stuff for the enthusiasts, but is for for everybody, potentially. So this would be my answer to distribution, is like aiming for this hypothetical, but hopefully coming. Maybe we can find, you know, it doesn't take, it, I don't think it take, it could be like something small and massive at the same time, such as Netflix deciding to distribute games on their platform, and Netflix entering the stage of game distribution through streaming, through, I don't know, but we need something like that as far as distribution goes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've been talking about this together, like how to solve this problem of curation and like have this audience able to rely on a content distributor that they can they feel is going to serve them content that they will appreciate, that like I don't know.
Cool. I'm going to call that the last question, but of course, Pietro consenting, you're available. You can ask him questions like in the break or at some point when he doesn't look busy. And otherwise, thank you so much. And let's give Pietro another round of applause.
Thank you.